Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this hearing of the Committee on Courts and Legal Services on the Mayor's Judicial Selection Process. We are joined by Council Members Barry Gordonchik from Queens, Andy Cohen from the Bronx, and Carlos Menchaca from Brooklyn. And I know we had Ben Kalos for a few minutes from Manhattan. Last year, in September 2016, at party judicial conventions held in each borough, 13 sitting New York City civil court judges were nominated as candidates in the November general election for the state Supreme Court. They won, as those nominated in New York City almost always do, and took office, thus vacating their civil court positions, on January 1st, 2017, nearly 4 months ago. State law charges the mayor with the responsibility for appointing judges to fill these civil court vacancies, to serve on an interim basis until new civil court judges can be elected at the following general election in November and take office the following January 1st. In other words, it's a one-year gig, but one that can be, and often has been, rolled over year to year to fill the new vacancies that arise every year. This responsibility of the mayor, so crucial to the maintenance of a well-functioning judicial system, cannot, by law, be shirked. Specifically, the New York City Civil Court Act, a state statute, provides that civil court vacancies, quote, shall be filled by the mayor, close quote. Further, Mayor de Blasio's Executive Order Number 4, which lays out the process by which the mayor makes his judicial appointments, is even clearer, quote, judicial vacancies shall be filled within 90 days unless a longer period is required in the public interest. The importance of this responsibility and the reason fulfilling it is mandatory is obvious in the general sense, but even more so in the context of the overwhelming backlog of cases and the unavailability of judges to conduct trials in particular. Almost invariably, interim civil court judges are actually assigned to sit in criminal court, which conducts arraignments in all criminal cases and handles all misdemeanor cases to conclusion, hundreds of thousands of cases a year. And our criminal courts are starving for judges. This committee conducted a hearing last year on the speedy trial crisis in New York City criminal court. The numbers are shocking. Citywide in 2015, the last full year for which data is available, it took misdemeanor and other low-level defendants on average 564 days to get before an actual jury, or 474 days if the case was tried by a judge. The wait in some boroughs was much longer. In the Bronx, the average wait for a jury trial in 2015 was 897 days. A class action suit has been filed alleging that defendants in the Bronx's due process rights are being violated. Such delays warp the administration of justice in this city as defendants take pleas just to get out of Rikers Island, or because they must take days off work to return to court dozens of times and wait countless hours as their case proceeds. Delay also frustrates victims and witnesses and impedes the ability of prosecutors to press cases to a fair conclusion. One of the significant drivers of delay is a lack of judges. At our hearing last year, we heard testimony about the shortage of judges from both district attorneys and public defenders. For example, the Queens District Attorney's Office testified, quote, we can't give the defendant a speedy trial if we can't give them a trial period. They told the committee that during an 8-month span, there were more than 500 cases where both defense and prosecution were ready to proceed to trial or hearing, but in 64% of those instances, a number that the Queens DA's office called astronomical, the case had to be adjourned because there was no trial parts available to conduct the proceedings. The executive director of Queens Law Associates, a public defender office, testified, quote, the shortage of criminal court judges is really a travesty. And yet, here we are, April 19th, and the mayor has still not filled 8 of the interim civil court judgeships, almost all of whom would certainly be assigned by the Office of Court Administration to sit in criminal court. This hearing is about why. The mayor has apparently decided that no longer will interim civil court judges be considered for rollover appointments for fear of compromising their independence. meaning unless an upcoming appointment to a 10-year official criminal court or family court judgeship is available, the interim court judgeship is truly a one-year gig. And on those terms, we are told it is difficult to find qualified candidates willing to give up their practices for a one-year stint in criminal court. I have found no member of the bench or bar that agrees with this policy. Just last month, at a public safety committee hearing, I put the question to all five district attorney's offices. They all lamented the lack of judges. Manhattan District Attorney Cy Vance testified. 1,500 cases in 2015 in Manhattan where prosecution defense showed up and there was no court to go to. Could be they needed more court officers or judges, but I don't mean to be flip. But this is not rocket science. If you have judges, cases will move fast. Lawyers, prosecutors said trial is starting next week and they decide if that moves forward. If you only have a couple of judges, the system is like a pond that is backed up. And what happens when that pond is backed up and stale is inadequate. Unfair justice system where people lose witnesses and not fair to the defendants. A representative of the Queens District Attorney's Office testified, quote, it is a very bad situation. Criminal court is a war of attrition. Whoever gives in first is going to win. We need to get more cases tried. There have been improvements. We do not want to discount that, but we have to understand where we came from. 8 criminal court jury trials in 2015, 20-something last year, nowhere near enough. We need more focus on the court that deals with 90% of criminal cases in criminal court, and it gets about 10% of the attention. We need those judges, and we need them right away. Close quote. In testimony submitted to today's hearing, written testimony, the executive director of the Brooklyn Defender Services states, we believe there is a need for more criminal court judges in Brooklyn. Each courtroom has enormous caseloads, and the adverse effects to justice are clear. She goes on to acknowledge that there are many reasons that justice is delayed in our criminal courts, but explicitly states, quote, the lack of a sufficient number of judges and available court parts compounds these problems. Additionally, one of the most well-respected and oft-cited scholars of legal ethics, Professor Stephen Gillers of NYU Law School, has submitted written testimony to the effect that while there might be a concern about judges worried that a district attorney or defense lawyer might put in a bad word with the mayor over an unfavorable ruling, this is easily remediable by the mayor's express commitment to not entertain any communication from the DAs asking him not to reappoint a judge on the ground that the judge's discretionary rulings have favored the defense generally or in a particular case, and to do likewise for defense lawyers. Because, as Professor Gillis states, quote, the public's interest in reducing a criminal case backlog is very strong. Moreover, even if the mayor's refusal to reappoint interim civil court judges was a sensible policy, there are many capable lawyers working in big firms, in government, and in the judiciary itself as court attorneys, referees, and in other staff positions who no doubt would very happily and capably serve a year as a judge sitting in criminal court. Which begs the question, why is it that 3 years into this administration, there hasn't been the outreach necessary to these potential applicants, if that is going to be the administration's policy? We look forward to hearing the administration's positions on these issues and its plan for fulfilling its responsibilities to appoint judges in a timely manner so that our city has a functioning judicial system. We're also particularly interested in whether, as Mr. Berger, our first witness, has stated, it is in fact the policy of this administration not to appoint interim civil court judges unless there is a full 10-year criminal court or family court vacancy they can fill the following year, or whether, as Corporation Counsel Zachary Carter has stated, the reason 8 judicial vacancies remain nearly 7 months after their existence became known to the administration is because, quote, there is an unusually high number of civil court vacancies this year. Okay. Mr. Berger, you're up first for the administration. If you'd raise your right hand so we can swear you in. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Yes. Thank you.
My name is Henry Berger, special counsel to the mayor. First, let me state that the authority of the mayor to appoint judges to the Family and Criminal Court and to fill interim vacancies on the civil court to derives from the New York State Constitution in Article 6, Sections 13, 15, and 21. That authority is unconstrained and limited solely by the requirements that judicial appointees be residents of the city and admitted to the bar as attorneys in New York for at least 10 years. Because this constitutionally constructed mandate to the mayor provides no limitations on his power to appointment other than that the candidates meet the requisite residence and experience requirements, the city council has no oversight jurisdiction over the mayor's exercise of his appointment of judges. Nevertheless, as a courtesy to our partners in the city council, we are appearing to provide testimony before you today. The mayor considers the appointment and reappointment of individuals to judicial office to be one of the most important duties. During his tenure, the mayor has filled more than 100 judicial positions, including 35 family court seats and 43 criminal court seats. In the past year, in preparation for judicial vacancies and completion of terms occurring at the end of the year, dozens of candidates have been reviewed, interviewed, and designated. Prior to the end of 2016, the mayor filled by reappointment or appointment all 17 vacancies occurring on January 1, 2017 on the criminal and family courts, including one reappointment to the family court occurring in mid-January. In addition, the mayor appointed 5 individuals to interim civil court vacancies created by the election of civil court judges to the Supreme Court in November 2016. Moreover, because there was an unusually large number of interim civil court vacancies, 13, created in the November 2016 election, additional candidates have been reviewed by the advisory committee and designated by the mayor for appointment, subject to consideration by the New York City Bar Association. That consideration is currently pending and outside of the administration's control. It is therefore inaccurate to say that the mayor has not acted on 8 outstanding appointments. The administration has in fact designated 9 candidates during the last 3 months, including a candidate for a criminal court seat that recently became vacant. Thus, the only vacancy for which the administration has not designated a candidate is an interim civil court seat resulted from the unexpected retirement of a judge on March 31, 2017. The process to fill that seat is nearly completed. Once the New York City Bar Association finishes its review and consideration, all of these 9 appointments will be immediately placed and finalized. I note that while the mayor's power to make such appointments is unconstrained, he has continued the practice adopted by mayors for nearly 40 years of limiting his selection to candidates whose qualification has been reviewed and passed upon by a screening panel, the mayor's advisory committee on the judiciary, established by executive order number 4, as well as by the judiciary committee of the Bar Association of the City of New York. The evaluation and consideration of candidates for those positions is both extensive and intensive. After completion of a lengthy application, each candidate, whether for appointment or reappointment, is reviewed by a subcommittee of the Mayor's Advisory Committee on the Judiciary, including extensive outreach to the references provided, as well as other members of the legal and lay community with whom the candidate has interacted. The candidate is subsequently interviewed by the subcommittee, and if approved, is then referred to the full committee for additional vetting and interviews. If approved by the full committee, the candidate is then interviewed by the executive committee comprised of the Corporation Counsel, the Counsel to the Mayor, the Special Counsel to the Mayor, and the Executive Director of the Advisory Committee. All candidates approved by the Advisory Committee are then interviewed by the Mayor, who decides which of the candidates are to be appointed or reappointed. The candidates approved by the Mayor are then reviewed by the Judiciary Committee of the New York City Bar Association, and this process is necessarily time-consuming but essential to assure that the people the mayor appoints will meet his high standards for these positions. Filling interim civil court vacancies presents a unique set of challenges. These appointments are for only 1 year. the assignment of candidates who go through the mayor's nonpartisan screening process, whether to civil, family, or criminal court, are determined solely by the Office of Court Administration. Unless there will be a family or criminal court seat available at the end of the appointment, there is no assurance that they will continue to have a position. Nor is it in the best interest of justice to simply reappoint interim civil court judges to another interim civil court seat. Judges should have the security of a fixed term to assure the independence of the judiciary. The advisory committee has done remarkable and commendable work over the last several months to recruit and evaluate candidates to enable the mayor to continue to fulfill his duty to continue to appoint highly qualified individuals to the judiciary. I may add here that there is no refusal to roll over a candidate into a civil court, into an additional interim civil court seat, but there is a reluctance to do so. And I think only of what happened with the Seattle federal court judge who had to rule on President Trump's immigration order. If he was on a one-year term, he would be looking over his shoulder while making that decision as to whether the executive would reappoint him. Our judges may not deal with presidential executive orders, but they deal with issues such as whether to incarcerate or set bail for an individual to take away that person's freedom, whether to remove a child from his or her family, or to place a child back with a family where there is the possibility of harm. And our journals, unfortunately, seem to always place the blame on the judge whenever there is an unfortunate outcome as a result of one of these decisions. Judges should not have to look year after year over their shoulders to see what the publicity and possible repercussions, public repercussions of their decisions, even though those decisions are entirely appropriate and legally required. So we do have a reluctance to continue to roll over, and that's a reluctance that we will continue, I think, to maintain. It must be noted that absolutely no indication that the current appointment process is playing a role in exacerbating the processing time of cases. As Judge Lippman noted in his recent report, delays in processing criminal cases are largely the result of a lack of non-judicial resources. The process of filling vacancies is an ongoing process, and to assure that only the most highly qualified individuals are appointed by the mayor to serve the people of New York in the judicial branch, the mayor will continue, in conjunction with his advisory committee and the New York City Bar Association, to rigorously review the qualifications of candidates and to appoint only those candidates who meet those exacting standards.
Thank you. Let's address this issue briefly. Of the administration's position that the council does not have jurisdiction in any way to conduct oversight over the mayor's process of appointing family court, criminal court, or interim civil court judges. I don't think it deserves much time, but since you've raised it, we're going to address it. Under the city charter, section 29, titled Power of Investigation and Oversight, the City Council, including committees like this one, may investigate any matters within its jurisdiction relating to the property, affairs, or government of the city, or of any county within the city, or to any other powers of the council, or to the effectuation of the purposes or provisions of this charter, or any laws relating to the city, or to any county within the city. Now, is it your position that the mayor's obligation to appoint civil court judges under the Constitution and under the New York City Civil Court Act, which is a state law that says that the mayor shall appoint interim civil court judges, is not a law relating to the city, which gives the council oversight jurisdiction under the charter?
The Constitution grants to the mayor the sole and exclusive power to make these appointments. His appointments are made pursuant to the Constitution. The appointees are not paid by the city. They are not responsible to the city. They are creatures of the state. The state assembly, the state senate would have oversight jurisdiction. The city council does not. These are not city officers. The mayor's power is one of the few powers that is granted solely and exclusively to him. The city council has no role in that process. Nonetheless, as a courtesy, we are glad to interact with the council on issues that they may raise concerning this matter.
So, again, I'll ask the question. The charter gives the council oversight jurisdiction over the effectuation of laws relating to the city. Is it your view that the authority that the mayor has to appoint the interim civil court judges under both the Constitution and the New York City Civil Court Act, which is a state statute, is not a law relating to the city?
It is our position that there are matters of state concern as well as city concern, but the oversight authority is limited to the state legislature, not to the city council. And we've had discussions with the Corporation Council on this, and they agree.
Let me ask something. The composition of the committee, the mayor's advisory committee on judicial appointments, I understand they're unpaid, they're providing the service volunteer basis, and are all distinguished individuals. You do a substantial amount of work on judicial appointments, do you not?
I do.
And you are an employee of the city, are you not? And your salary is approved in the city budget, is it not?
I assume so.
And that city budget is voted on by the city council, is it not?
Yes, it is.
Are there other staff members of the mayor's who work on the judicial appointment process?
There are a number of people who work for the mayor who work on this process, and they are designated by the mayor pursuant to his exclusive sole power to appoint judges.
And it's your position, it's the administration's position, that these employees of the city, including yourself, who are paid by tax dollars, appropriated through the budget that the council votes on, are immune from oversight in the way that they conduct the judicial, in the way they conduct their process of assisting the mayor in making a decision on who to appoint to these various judgeship positions.
You can oversight me, you can't oversight the mayor and what he does. And it's the mayor who makes the appointments, and that's the only issue.
Okay.
Whatever we do is part of whatever we do with every issue before the mayor, which is to provide him with the best information we possibly can.
The
power here is the mayor's, and your oversight, or what you claim to be your oversight, is over the mayor's appointment of judges. You don't have authority to do that. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, we're here. We can continue to discuss this. I assume the substance is more important than this issue.
Well,
we're willing to sit here and discuss that issue.
Insofar as the administration, until either early this morning or late this night, took the position that it was not going to produce a witness and the subpoenas were being drafted, and now you're here and we're welcome that you are here. There is this ongoing debate, apparently, between the administration and the council as to the extent of our jurisdiction. And since you choose to include that in your testimony, I didn't write your testimony for you, sir, since you choose to include that in the testimony, I want to explore it just a little bit. I'll make the final observation, and then I want to move on as well. There are many things that the charter grants to the mayor in his exclusive authority and his sole decision-making power, a view of the council's oversight authority that is limited only to those circumstances where the council and the mayor somehow directly share responsibility for decision-making would eviscerate the council's oversight authority entirely.
Hardly. As you said, where the charter grants a power that's under city law, and you have oversight. Where the state constitution grants sole and exclusive authority to the mayor, you have no oversight. period.
The problem with that analysis that I have is that the city charter, in establishing the city council's authority, makes specific reference to state law.
The city charter can't overrule the state constitution. The city is a creature of the state. When the constitution does something, that is a limiting authority.
You are aware that there's a New York City Civil Court Act which was passed by the state legislature. Is it your view that that is unconstitutional and that that statute is void?
Not at all, because it's the Civil Court Act adopted by the state legislature pursuant to their constitutional authority. Mm-hmm. It's a state law. It's not a city law.
But the city charter explicitly references any laws relating to the city. You're saying that that refers only to laws relating to the city passed by the city? That it only refers to the administrative code? And that the council doesn't have oversight over the mayor when it comes to his effectuating any of the very, very many state law requirements imposed upon New York City or the mayor?
Under your theory, almost every law that's adopted by the state legislature affects the city. That doesn't give you oversight authority over the state budget, over a lot of other issues. This is a sole and exclusive power of the mayor. We're glad to be here today to talk to you, but you know, we're here as a courtesy.
Well, I hope we have the opportunity to test that proposition one day in a court of law. So let's get down to it. I wrote to you in January about this issue, and you responded with a letter which summarized which your testimony summarized. And I just want to clarify. Is it this administration's policy that the mayor will not appoint interim civil court judges without an anticipated full 10-year term criminal or family court judge vacancy to appoint them to the following year?
I addressed that in my testimony, and it is not a policy not to. It is a reluctance, and it's a reluctance because of the importance of the independence of the judiciary. I note in that regard that your quote in the New York Law Journal was that that argument was ridiculous. Any lawyer who believes that an independent judiciary is ridiculous should turn in their law license. An independent judiciary is the foundation of our democracy, and we will continue to defend the independence of the judiciary, rolling over judges year to year to year so they're always up for reappointment, as has happened in past administrations, is bad. Judges cannot be independent under those circumstances, and we are reluctant to do it, but we fill vacancies as we find qualified candidates and as we believe that there will be vacancies available in the future.
Well, we'll get into the mechanics of why in January you wrote that for the reasons stated above, it is unlikely that all of those seats will be filled.
In January, it was unlikely.
And now,
fortunately,
and now in April, we're being told that the mayor has designated these folks, and they're just waiting for the Bar Association to approve them. We'll get to that.
I want to focus on
the independence.
You raised the issue, and let me respond to it. It's not going unanswered. In January, when I wrote that letter, it was unlikely. There were a huge number of those vacancies. There were 13 civil court vacancies. Double what we usually get. The mayor's advisory committee, 19 private, unpaid, volunteer individuals, remarkable people, did an amazing job going out, searching for candidates, recruiting candidates, reviewing them, putting them through the process. Fortunately, we are able to fill those vacancies because of the work the committee did. I thought it was unlikely, we all thought it was unlikely, that we would have enough qualified, highly qualified candidates to do it. It turns out that there were. Situations change over months. I set forth the situation as it was in January. And as I said in that letter, filling judicial vacancies is an ongoing process. The committee is always working on it. We're always working on it. We were able to do it. We're working now on on further anticipated vacancies.
It's an ongoing process. Mr. Berger, if you don't see a disconnect between telling me in late January that it's unlikely that all those seats will be filled, and then the Corporation Council saying 2 months later, oh, we've got this. We've already made these designations. We're just waiting for the Bar Association to vet them. So be it. Let's talk about independence.
Well, first of all, it's 3 months later. And second of all, the committee works. Look, the process is a time-consuming process. The New York State Judicial Nominating Committee just came out with a schedule to fill a single seat on the Court of Appeals. It's a six-month schedule. The committee has 4 months, the governor has a month, and the Senate has a month. It's a six-month process for one seat. We were filling more than 30 seats. It's an ongoing process, and we're going to continue to do that process the way we're doing it to make sure that we get the most highly qualified candidates.
So let's get to the issue of judicial independence, because none of the legal ethics professors that we consulted, none of the bar associations that we consulted, I'm not aware of any authority out there for the proposition that rolling over judges from year to year so compromises judicial independence in some unique way that would justify not making appointments on that basis. The system in New York, I mean, you referred to the federal judge in Seattle. As you know, federal judges have life tenure. As I'm sure you also know, there are no judges in New York State that have life tenure. They have 10-year terms, they have 14-year terms. Unless they either plan not to run for re-election or not to seek reappointment, or their term, they will turn 70 years old within the span of their term and they're ineligible for reappointment or re-election. Isn't every judge in New York State, including those appointed to 10-year terms by the mayor, in some way, shape, or form compromised by the fact that they too will have to at some point seek reappointment from their appointing authority or go to the electorate to get reelected? And in fact, from the research that we did, there are, for example, now, I think, a moment. I don't have the exact number in front of me. There are a certain number of family court judges and a certain number of criminal court judges who are in the last year of their 10-year term. So are they, in fact, is their independence compromised? I don't understand this focus on the one-year interim judges, especially when this is not some innovative policy that I'm suggesting, but prior mayors rolled judges over from year to year as they saw fit. And I'm not aware of any examples of those judges not exercising independence. What is so unique about a judge with a one-year term year to year for a short period of time until there's an opening for a longer appointment? And all the judges throughout the court system who, at some point in their tenure, are in the last year or the next to last year or 3 years away from having to be reappointed or facing the electorate.
You know, there's been so much written and there's so much philosophical discussion about this issue, but there's a major difference between 10-year terms and 14-year terms and rolling over one-year term after one-year term after one-year term. That's why some states have adopted a system called the Missouri system, which after a judge has been on the bench for 3 or 4 years, they get an approval and they have a continuing lifetime appointment. Why federal judges have lifetime appointments. We can debate back and forth whether a lifetime appointment is better or worse than a 10-year appointment or a 14-year appointment. 10-year appointments and 14-year appointments, certainly, you know, there is a need for re-election, but it's not the same thing as always being up reconsideration year after year after year. And it's our position, it's a, you know, it's a policy decision that that's not a good thing to do.
Do you think that the independence of the year-to-year folks for the few years that they are year-to-year, and presumably you would only appoint them in the first place if you had high confidence in their character and their qualifications, you would only reappoint them in for the second year or the third year if you had a high confidence in their character, their integrity, and their independence and their qualifications. Do you think that this concern over independence and whether the year-to-year is that much different from people in the last year of, or last couple years of a 10-year, 40-year term, would justify leaving a judicial seat vacant and unavailable to contribute to reducing the backlog in criminal court?
Well, getting rid of the last editorial comment, yes, we would.
It's not editorial comment, it's a question. And I'd like you to answer.
The answer is yes, because there's no indication that any of this results in delay in the criminal courts. Let me just note, of the 13 civil court judges who got elected creating these 13 vacancies, not one of them was sitting in the criminal court. None of these vacancies reduced the number of judges on the criminal court by a single judge. If there's a shortage of judges on the criminal court, there may be two reasons for it. One, it may require legislative action to appoint more judges, but two, OCA has a tradition of taking judges from the criminal court and assigning them to other courts. If those judges are really needed on the criminal court, they should be left on the criminal court. None of the vacancies created by the election of these 13 judges came from the criminal court. They were not sitting there. It did not reduce the number of judges on the criminal court by a single judge.
But this has not resulted. The judges that you appoint, that the mayor appoints, almost all of them will be assigned to criminal court, correct?
Not necessarily. OCA can assign them to the civil court.
They certainly have that authority. There's no question OCA has that authority. But let's be honest here. Almost all of these judges will be assigned to the criminal court.
That's not necessarily true. In past years, many of them have been assigned to the family court.
That was before the family court judges were increased by the state legislature, right?
That's not true. Of the five we appointed before January 1, either two or three of them were assigned to the family court.
Okay, and the others were assigned to criminal court.
That was a decision that the Office of Court Administration made. They may go to family court, they may go to criminal court, or they may actually sit in civil court.
So let me address something else you just mentioned, and then also in your testimony, and then I assume my colleagues have some questions. And this assertion that you made, and that Corporation Counsel Zach Carter made, to the effect that appointing these judges and they're being assigned to criminal court is not going to make a difference in the backlog and the situation in the readiness crisis, the speedy trial crisis in the criminal court. And you are a distinguished member of the bar. Zach Carter is one of the leading members of the bar in New York City. But I marvel at how you're willing to substitute your judgment on that from the district attorneys and the public defenders who practice in criminal court. I mean, Cy Vance testified within the last month, quote, "This is not rocket science. If you have judges, cases will move fast." The Queens District Attorney's Office testified, quote, "We need those judges, and we need them right away." And you heard the testimony. I read part of the testimony from Brooklyn defenders. Why is the administration unwilling to acknowledge that adding judges to the criminal court would be beneficial in reducing the backlog of cases that exist in criminal court? It seems like you're denying that 2 + 2 = 4. What do you and Zachary Carter know that the district attorneys and the public defenders don't?
We just don't disagree.
Your questions, right?
We just don't disagree with former Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman We do not disagree with former Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman, who said in his recent report, delays are largely the result of a lack of non-judicial resources. We don't disagree with the current Chief Judge, Janet DeFiore, who in moving to eliminate delays is working not on adding more judges, but is working on reforming the system within what they have so that lawyers don't always ask for adjournments, et cetera, et cetera. You can't open a court part, you can't open a criminal court part unless you have two court officers, you have a stenographer, you have a court clerk, all state employees. Judge Lippman says that's what's missing. Not lack of judges, and Judge DeFiore says we don't have to add judges to get rid of the delay, we have to improve the system and within which the judges work. So adding a judge here or there, you know, apparently, and we're not going to disagree with this, isn't creating the delay. If it were, the Office of Court Administration could, of course, leave criminal court judges on the criminal court to handle those cases. They have decided not to do so. So we don't believe that within our system, what we do adds to the delay. If there is a delay and they need more judges, then I think we should all go to the state legislature and ask them to create more judicial positions. They did that in the family court 2 years ago, and we got 9 more family court judges,
What if the state legislature came back and said, we directed the mayor to appoint interim civil court judges, and he's not doing it in a timely manner?
He is doing it, and he's doing it in a timely manner.
It's April 19th.
And he's made the designations, and, you know, hopefully they will be filled. You know, hopefully the Bar Association will act, and things will move along. But we've done our piece on an ongoing basis. We have filled since December 31, yeah, more than 30 vacancies.
And by the way, you knew these vacancies were going to become available, open on January 1st. You knew that in September after the judicial nominating conventions, right?
Not necessarily. We still believe in the electoral process. But
is it the case that after the judicial nominating conventions in September, you waited until the election in November just to make sure that these judges were actually going to win?
That is not true.
So you knew about in September that these vacancies would come open on January 1st?
We knew there would be vacancies, and the committee had been working for months at that point in recruiting and reviewing and evaluating candidates.
Okay.
As I said, it's an ongoing process. That process goes on year-round, and, you know, we anticipate what's going to happen in the future. You know, sometimes the anticipations change. One of those was that we had an unusually large number of interim civils this year, and that changed, but we continued the process, and we have continued. We didn't stop on January 1 and say, well, we've done our job and we're going home. We continued to work in December and January and February and March to get these reviews done and to make the designations, and the mayor has made his designations.
Got it. We've been joined by Council Member Vanessa Gibson, and we have questions from colleagues on the order that were here. Council Member Gordencia, Council Member Andy Cohen, Council Member Menchaca.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon, Mr. Berger. It's nice to see you.
Good to see you.
I'm not an attorney. I just want to make that clear.
Congratulations.
And I do believe in an independent judiciary. My mother tried, but it didn't work. I think I've never heard, I've been around the corner for 30 years in this city, in government, out of government, I have never heard of people having a shortage of judges, and I appreciate that people have to be cleared. Do you advertise these positions? Does the mayor take out an ad anywhere? When I'm looking for employees, I put an ad on Craigslist, or I wouldn't expect you would do that for a judge, but do you, in the law journal, or is it word of mouth? How's it done?
It's more than word of mouth. There is outreach. The Bar Association, particularly the City Bar, will do a how to become a judge, which is advertised in the Bar Journal, and we participate in that. We reach out to virtually every bar association in the city of New York, to community groups. We ask electeds and party officials to make recommendations to us. We ask community groups to make recommendations. And people submit applications. They make inquiry and they submit applications. It's an extensive application, and not all of them will meet our standards.
I appreciate that. I wouldn't think everybody would meet a standard, especially to be a judge. It should be a very high standard, and I know there are background checks and the like. We can anticipate, though, that in any given year, starting on January 1st, there will be vacancies in the courts of the City of New York, to which, as you've testified, the mayor has sole authority to appoint officials, judges. Have you considered, have you, any of your colleagues considered having a pre-qualified list so that we wouldn't have to wait until April 19th, as the chair has pointed out?
Yeah, I've actually thought about that. I don't know if it's institutional, but since the process is an ongoing year-round process, we're always looking for candidates, we're always qualifying candidates, and the vacancies keep occurring. Since January 1 of this year, there have been 4 resignations, and we anticipate another one. So even as we do it, we keep filling vacancies, and it's an ongoing process. Can we ever get ahead of the process? I don't know. Can we tell somebody, next time there's a vacancy, we'll appoint you to fill it, and there may be one next January 1. I think that's difficult. Is it impossible? No. But we're doing it on an ongoing basis, and we'll fill the 30 vacancies that were existent on January 1. We'll fill the 4. All of those are in process. If not, at completion, very close to completion, we do it on an ongoing basis, and we're going to continue to do that.
Would you at least take back to the mayor that at least I think it would be a good idea to pre-qualify people? And I also think the question that I have, and I know that before you're considered to be a judge, you go, when for elective judge, that people are pre-cleared by, whether it's a county bar association or a city bar association, would it make more sense for the mayor to do that as well, so that by the time that they got to you, say Rory Lantzman wanted to be a judge, which he swears he doesn't want to be, but just say for this instance he said he wanted to be one, would it make sense for the bar association to pre-clear him so that by the time he got to you, we wouldn't be waiting for them? Is there an ethical constraint that I'm missing here, or?
Within the electoral system, they don't pre-clear. They clear them after they've been designated in one form or another. But
I'm pretty sure that at least
we've asked the Bar Association to participate in the process. And at one time, in fact, they considered the candidates before the mayor made his or her designation. But the mayor reviews several candidates for each vacancy, and they just did not have the capacity to do that. So we've worked out the system with them that after the mayor makes his designation, then they consider it. They're considering 9 right now. That's a bunch. And it's going to take them a few weeks to do that. To ask them to consider 18 or more, they just don't believe that they would have the capacity to do it. And we certainly want to have as much input as we can into the process to make sure that we're not missing anything, to make sure that we really are getting the most highly qualified. There was a suggestion earlier, if I can just comment on it, that, if you're worried about the ethics issues and, undue influence of prosecutors and defense attorneys, don't let them comment on the candidates. Well, that would be an absolute disaster. These are the people who best know the candidates, and we want their input. We want to know what they think about it. And we get reports on each of these judges with the results of each of the interviews. And for each candidate, there may be 25 or 30 interviews.
I know it's extensive, and I've participated.
They're not always uniform. Sometimes people say negative things, and then you look into, this is an attorney who represented a client on a losing case and didn't didn't think it was fair, whatever, and they're negative, but the other 29 comments are all positive. We certainly want the maximum amount of input and not start eliminating whole classes of people from providing input.
I appreciate that. My last question, I understand you feel pretty strongly about the security of a fixed term, and I think we all do. We value an independent judiciary. It's one of the most important things that keeps this country, this city, this state going. Would it be prudent, in your opinion, to have a one-in-one situation? You know, if you make the first one, maybe you get the second one. So what I'm saying is, you've been appointed to a year interim term, and then you could get a maximum of another year, so that the mayor would have more discretion, whoever he or she may be, going forward, so that we wouldn't have vacancies on the court, and it would be limited just to one. You'd get an extra a year.
Look, if we can avoid the extra year, we really try to do it. We've had a few rollovers over the past few years. Sometimes affirmatively decided upon, sometimes because there just wasn't a vacancy. We would really prefer to put as many people as we can, as quickly as we can, into full terms. We just think it's a better matter of policy.
I think it is a better matter of policy. I agree with you on that. But I think that, you know, we also have a vacancies here, and it does slow down the administration of justice, which we are all concerned about in this city. I thank you for your answering my questions. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Councilmember Cohen.
Thank you, Chair. I don't know what it says about me, but I've actually enjoyed this hearing so far. So
so have I. Thank you.
Good. I just want to get a handle on what the problem, if there is a problem, maybe there isn't a problem. I'm not 100% clear myself from the testimony so far. Of the people that you've appointed as interim acting civils, I guess most have gone on to get appointments, or all have gone on to get appointments to either the family court or the criminal court?
Well, over our 3 years of appointments, as I said, we had a few who we had to roll over. But every one of them, there was one judge we didn't reappoint after a rollover. That's public knowledge. We wanted to examine the judge's credentials, but every one of them through last year, having been appointed to a civil, an interim civil, ultimately got a family or criminal court seat. And we're hoping that with the interim civils that we're appointing now, that in short order, they will get family or criminal court seats. We have a small problem this year. As of the moment, there are no vacancies at the end of the year on the family court. It's an unusual situation. There are seven vacancies on the criminal court as of now. So we know that we have at least those seven seats, plus we know that there may be some vacancies. We were just told recently about a vacancy that's going to occur in June. Now, in theory, that could create another interim civil suit. Do we put somebody in June just for 6 months if we know there's not going to be a vacancy for him at the end of the year? Probably not. I mean, it just doesn't make sense. We know we have seven seats coming up at the end of the year. There may be more because of resignations. And we're going to end up rolling over a very small number, but we're going to minimize that number to the extent we can.
I mean, it seems highly likely, though, from the number of appointments. I mean, you testified that you've made over 100 appointments, or about 100 appointments, that it's an ongoing thing, that if you appoint someone to civil court today, that there's a high likelihood, maybe not on January 1st, but at some point that they will get an appointment. Why would we just not, you know, if you have to, you know, serve an 18-month term instead of a 1 year, well, why is that so onerous?
Because we look back at the history, and there were judges who were being rolled over one and two and three, in one case, four times. We want to avoid that. There are always new people coming into the system, and there are good people, and we want to make sure, you know, we continue to have room for them. We're going to fill as many of these vacancies as we can, as quickly as we can, within the constraints of making sure that we get the most highly qualified people.
Yeah, I just want to make one argument also. I was a law secretary for many years. I've been a judicial delegate in New York County and Bronx County, so, and But I would say that experience on as a judicial delegate, there have been occasions where I've seen people elected to the courts who I think they're not that great. And there's an argument to be made for having an audition. Like, this is a great opportunity where we could actually get better judges if we appointed them to an interim appointment, and we could say, wow, this person did not really have what it takes. And it would give us an opportunity to, rather than locking ourselves in for 10 years or in 14 years, you have an opportunity to say, what better job interview than to have someone do the job for a year and say, wow, this person is, can't move the docket, not particularly decisive. I mean, all the things that we've seen over the years of judges who are not that good, it seems like we're missing an opportunity, perhaps.
Well, I think you raise an interesting point. As you may be aware, I testified in federal court on the suit that challenged nomination of judges by judicial convention, because judicial conventions don't have the kind of rigorous, intensive screening process before the judges get to that. And, I think, quite frankly, that the judges we appoint to the criminal and family court are more likely to be highly qualified than candidates who come through a system where there isn't that kind of merit screening before they actually get to the designation process. So, comparing it to Supreme Court, you and I can argue about some of the judges who over the years have been appointed. I've been a judicial delegate going back almost 40 years now. So it's, we believe that the judges we are appointing, given the extensive review that they get, are going to be successful. And it's a much more rigorous process than the election process because of the levels of review that we make our candidates go through. And as a result, if we can avoid multiple one-year terms, we're going to continue to do that.
I hear you, and I'm not aware particularly. And I go to court periodically now, often with constituents where sometimes support for a variety of reasons. And I will say, particularly in criminal court, I'm often the bar knows who I am, and I'm deluged by attorneys saying that there is an inability to get a trial, particularly in Bronx County, that's a real challenge. So anything I think that we can do to try to, maybe a handful of judges is not going to make a 800 days is just, offensive to us, I think, to every lawyer in the room. And making it 775 is not going to be profound, but 25 days is 25 days, particularly if you're sitting in Rikers for those 25 days, I suppose. So I would encourage anything that we can do to make the process as efficient as possible and as quick as possible. And again, I do think that there is, while I understand keeping people on the hook for reappointments has a downside, I think that they're also, it could be counterbalanced by the opportunity to kind of see these people actually perform the job. And I think that that's a benefit as a delegate. And again, even people who are highly qualified with high educations, that doesn't always translate to being a good judge. You could be a very good lawyer and not be a very good judge. I'm sure we can all think of instances where there were very good lawyers who, temperamentally wise, it turned out that while they were good litigators, they were not good judges. There are a variety of reasons. So I think in some ways having an interim appointment is an opportunity that maybe the mayor should take advantage of.
As we interview candidates for reappointment, we often get into discussions about the problems in the courts and the delays. And there are two places where it's evident. One is in Queens County for some reason, and the other is in the Bronx. And you're, of course, very familiar with the Bronx. And the chief judge has certainly taken that on as a major task, with apparently some significant success within the resources that they have. I mean, the New York Times did a series of articles about what causes delay. Everybody has an interest in adjourning a case. The prosecution isn't ready. The defense thinks the longer you wait, the more likely you're going to get off. The judges, have huge calendars, and it's easy just to put it over. There are lots of reasons. And I think what the chief judge is doing in the Bronx is saying, enough of that. Set firm deadlines. People always move up to the deadline they have. Set firm deadlines. And it's having a great success within the resources they have. In Queens, we were told that one of the problems they were having at one point was they didn't have enough courtrooms. that's a major problem. You can't have a trial if you don't have a courtroom, and you know, and judges were sort of juggling courtroom. There are a number of problems, and look, the more resources you have, the more likely it is that things are going to move along. But even if you have the resources, there are lots of other things that will affect this. Let's keep moving.
Yeah. I listen, I'm not blaming the mayor for the delays in Bronx County. There's a myriad of, we could write a book on all the reasons why. I can't tell you how many times I've sat in a courtroom waiting for, there's no defendant because it can't be produced from Rikers Island. Court's called for 9:30. The defendant arrives at around 11:30. We break for lunch and then we go home. I mean, that's how it works. So that's I understand that. But again, I would encourage that the mayor do everything he can to keep these appointments as fast as they can be made. Thank you, Chair.
We agree totally. Yes.
Thank you, Council Member and fellow judicial delegate, Council Member Menchaca.
Thank you, Chair Lantzman, and I want to thank you for this hearing as well. This is a great opportunity to shed light on something that probably a lot of New Yorkers don't know about, so I'm really happy that we're having this very public discussion. I have a few sets of questions, and I'm going to start really where I think the discussion started, which was the state responsibility and oversight. I want to get a sense from you all, from you, Mr. Berger, and really from the kind of position that you've taken on this as far as roles and responsibilities, where has the state, in the time that you've been in this role, performed any oversight on this question about judicial nominations? Have they done some form of oversight, and what was that, and when was that?
The only oversight there is comes from the Office of Court Administration, with whom we are in frequent contact, and the work that the Chief Judge is doing on a state level, which is trying to, figure out what causes the delays in those counties where there is delays. And,
And repeat that again. This is court?
Office of Court Administration. It's a state Office of Court Administration responsible for all the courts in the state.
And so they are providing some oversight. They're an administration office. So they report. Tell me a little bit about the way the format here.
The Chief Judge of the State of New York is the Chief Judge of the Court of Appeals and the Chief Administrative Judge. In her role as Chief Administrative Judge, there exists the Office of Court Administration, which takes care of all of the administrative issues in the court, which includes, among other things, hiring court officers and stenographers and clerks, but also assigning the judges. So the Office of Court Administration can take a civil court judge, assign them to the criminal court, the family court, or even make them an acting Supreme Court judge and assign them to the Supreme Court. And they do this on a regular basis. They move judges around. So they move judges out of the criminal court and into the family court, or out of the criminal court and into the Supreme Court. They take civil court judges and move them around. But they decide, ultimately, this is how many judges we're going to have in criminal court, and this is where they're going to sit. This is how many judges we're going to have in family court. This is where they're going to sit. And this is how many judges we're going to have in Supreme Court, and this is where they're going to sit. They make those determinations.
And the they is still on the Office of Court Administration that's led
yes.
by a chief judge that is making this
right.
decision for the city of New York, and I'm assuming there's a jurisdiction.
For the whole state.
For the whole state.
This is for the whole state.
Got it. Okay. This is so. I'm also not a lawyer, so this is education for me as well, and so I guess the next question, and this is now kind of leading to a more broader discussion about really studying the impacts. Is this office, and in coordination with you, designing a kind of report of some kind that really kind of outlines some of those issues? It sounds like you've had discussions about this issue. And are they designing some kind of report in the near future? I'm kind of really pointing to data. I'd like to kind of see some information that sounds like might be happening.
The Office of Court Administration collects all sorts of numbers.
Great. Are those available? Is that available to the public?
I don't know whether it is or not.
Okay.
But they have standards and goals where every case is supposed to be dealt with in a specific amount of time, and if a judge doesn't, they report that they are, quote, over standards and goals, and they keep track of those statistics. And there were administrative judges who were supposed to work with judges who have a frequent number of cases over standards and goals and try to figure out how to move them along. But they keep a variety of statistics about how long cases take and how long each judge is taking with his or her cases.
This is all data being captured on on the system itself. Okay, so then here's my next question is really, and this is something you just brought up in the previous Q&A about resources. And so I'm assuming that there's some things that have risen as far as resources and need for courtroom and court spaces. Do these things happen in city property at all? Or is this all state property and state courts? I wish I knew. I don't know. So I'm hoping that you
It's
knew.
A strange amalgam. The city is responsible for building and maintaining the courthouses.
The city, I just wanted to say that again. The city is responsible. Okay.
But that is done in conjunction with the state, which of course provides and pays for all the personnel within the courthouses. If somebody decides they need a new courthouse, there's a back and forth discussion. They just opened recently a new courthouse in Staten Island for the Supreme Court. And that was a back and forth because ultimately, you know, it's OCA and the state coming to us and saying we want to build a new courthouse and then, you know, figure out siting and where to do it, how much it's going to cost and whatever. We get the bill for it. They essentially make the decision and we get the bill for it is how it works.
Got it. So there's a city budget allocation that has to happen as well. Okay, look, it sounds like there's some gray area, there's some partnership work, but I'm really kind of pointing to a larger question. I don't want to take too much more time. I know there's some council members that want to ask more questions, but I think there's an opportunity for us to, while there might be some rigid lines that you've expressed today about oversight, there is a responsibility for the public to have information about where allocation and city money is going to assist in this process. And so there is some responsibility that I think people are going to want to take as New Yorkers and as representatives of those New Yorkers. I think we're going to have something to say about that. So now I want to talk a little bit about roles, and actually you answered some of my questions about vacancies. Right now you have 7 vacancies, is that right?
No, at the end of the year.
At the end of this year.
There are 7 criminal court judges who are reaching the age of 70 this year and will have to retire as of December 31st.
Got it. Thank you for clarifying that. Thank you. And is – actually, this is a general – this is off – are these either vacancies published online in some way? Is there anything that exists online that tells a story about what's happening?
I don't think OCA maintains that. I'm just not sure.
Okay.
I know there used to be in the Green Book a listing of the judges when their terms were up, and if they were subject to retirement. I'm not even sure if that still exists anymore.
Got it. But not on like city the .gov, NYC.gov work, or website. None of this exists.
I don't know.
Great. Okay, we can come back and follow up on that. And then finally, you mentioned like a group of folks that help assist the committee on either nominations. What is the role? What are the roles of? There are two specific folks that I want to ask about. Organizations and what those organizations are. If there's a clean way to talk about, you're going to go to all the legal service providers or whatever, and the county. It sounds like there's county roles that are part of your process. I want to get a better understanding about who you're talking about. The county. You speak about the county and who those people are, and how they assist.
In terms of recruiting,
we'll recruiting speak, candidates, yes.
Recruiting. We'll speak to anybody who will speak to us. And, you know, we go to, you know, the committee, the advisory committee has 19 members, and they're all encouraged to do outreach. We all do. The Corporation Council does it. The Council to the Mayor meets with organizations and does it. And anybody we speak to, you know, we all, look, if you have candidates, have them the advisory committee website, download the application, and submit it. There are no political requirements. You know, you don't have to have been a member of a club or whatever. Anybody can go on that website and download the application, and it will be reviewed just like all of the other applications. So we do outreach. If there are other organizations that anybody wants to recommend, we'll reach out to them. You know, we affirmatively seek more and more people in any way we possibly can.
So I guess, but I was asking a specific question about counties and what you meant in your earlier testimony about working with counties. What does that mean? Can you give me an example?
Among the groups we talk to are all of the political people.
Okay, which include
not only electeds but also party officials, because you know these people represent their communities and are familiar with their communities and have contacts within their communities.
Mm-hmm.
And you know whether it's a Democratic County organization or an insurgent club or even non-democratic political organizations, they can all make recommendations. They all have input. They or have the potential for input. They know their communities. And we treat them as we do all community groups in this. We're reaching out because you know who the people are. You can make recommendations. You can find people for
us. And are any of these recommendations made public of when you've received applications, names from political organizations or organizations that are connected to the committee, the 19-member committee, are any of those made public to your knowledge?
That's all confidential. The only names that ever come out are the people who actually get appointed, so that if somebody goes in and doesn't make it, you know, there's nobody going to say, "Oh my gosh, mm-hmm. they didn't get it."
And what's the protection? What's the protection on confidentiality? For what reason?
It's a very close circle. I mean, you know, the people who work on it are the committee members, the staff of the advisory committee is a grand total of three people, and then there are the people within the administration who work on it. So far as I know, it's been a pretty secure system. I mean, everybody understands that what goes on in the committee stays in the committee.
So my final question.
It's been effective.
I'm taking a lot of time, and I want to respect the chair's hearing. The last question I have is: if any of that were to change, does the mayor have the power to change that, or is there a kind of system that is set by the Constitution that, and all the questions that I've asked about reports, online dissemination of information about who's who. Like an online green book version of these judges and who's terming out, all of that, and then potentially making some things public about where and who is nominating. Does the mayor have the power to change that system?
The mayor has the power to change anything that directly affects the appointment, so that he's created by Executive Order 4 the mechanism by which the recruitment review evaluation.
So he has power to change that mechanism.
Right. I mean, literally, the mayor could walk down the street, walk up to somebody and say, "Are you a resident of New York? Have you been admitted to the bar 10 years? I'm appointing you a judge."
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the power he has.
That's the power he has, but certainly that's...
And then everything else is kind of constructed around that right now to create a system that has...
The mayor is, of course, created, and it's, you know, it wasn't his originally. It goes back in one form or another, actually, to John Lindsay's second term in 1969, where there were the first sort of mayoral screening panels. But in terms of other things, the Green Book issue is something I want to look into because, you know, it used to be there, and I just haven't had a chance to look at it recently. It may still be. But,
okay.
But, you know, I think that the outreach, particularly through the various bar associations,
mm-hmm.
enables us to let the potential candidates, members of the bar who've been admitted 10 years, know that there's a non-political system. There are a lot of people who don't know that, and we continue to do that kind of outreach. And it's always interesting when the city bar does their How to Become a Judge day-long seminars, so many people said, "I didn't know you could become a judge without going through a political system." And, you know, So we keep trying to emphasize and reemphasize that and do more reach out to more, you know, there are more and more bar associations. There are, you know, there are interest group bar associations, and we reach out to them to let the potential candidates know, you know, all you do is submit a written application. You don't have to talk to anybody. Submit it. It's going to get rigorously reviewed, but you fill out that application with 30-some-odd questions with subparts and whatever. You know, make it available. The mayor's created this extensive review process to make sure that the consideration in appointing judges is only that the person be highly qualified, that there aren't other, you know, requirements to get the job.
Thank you.
Thank you, and okay, we'll follow up on some of these items. Thank you.
Thanks. I want to go back to what brought us here, and what I understand you to characterize the current policy to be your, correct me if I'm using the wrong term, but the reluctance to appoint someone to an interim civil court judgeship if there is not a reasonable likelihood that in the following year there'll be a family court or criminal court appointment. Is it the case, are there circumstances where you anticipate the committee will not make a recommendation to the mayor for an appointment because there is no family court or criminal court appointment likely the next year? I want to understand just that, the scope of
that is not a committee consideration. That's not a consideration of the committee. That's a consideration once it gets beyond the committee.
Okay. So is it the position of the administration that there are circumstances where because there is not a family court or criminal court 10-year term appointment on the horizon in the next year, that an appointment will not be made to fill that interim civil court vacancy? I want to understand what you mean by reluctance and the extent to which that will, in fact, be a bar in any circumstance to choosing someone.
It's not a bar, it's a consideration. This year, because the committee did such a remarkable job finding really, really qualified candidates, the last group of candidates they sent to us was very strong. The mayor has designated candidates for appointment, even though we know it's beyond the 7 criminal court seats that are available, and that, you know, it is likely that some of those are going to be rolled over, because the committee really, you know, as I said, did a remarkable job and came up with some very strong candidates. But it's a consideration, and it's something we look at. It's one of the factors.
So can you tell us that their city will not have a no rollover policy? There are many factors that go into the decision of making it.
We've never had a no rollover policy. Mm-hmm. We have, as I expressed it, and perhaps it could be articulated better, a reluctance to roll judges over from year to year.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, just to be clear, in terms of how one expresses things, and we all can express ourselves poorly or not in the way that we had intended, but we are here because on January 26th, you informed us that for the reasons stated above, primarily the issue of judicial independence, it is unlikely that all of those seats will be filled. I just want to be clear that, at least according to your testimony today, the administration is not going to decline to fill a vacancy in the interim civil court slot because there is not a 10-year family court or criminal court appointment on the horizon.
I think I've answered that.
If you could answer that question, I think we've heard it in different ways, and I anticipate what your answer will be, but I want to get an answer to that question on the record.
one of the considerations. Mm-hmm. It's not a determinative consideration. It is a consideration.
Okay. And just to be clear, do you agree that such a policy would be inconsistent with the New York City Civil Court Act, which is a state statute?
No.
Which you don't believe that it would be inconsistent?
No.
Okay. Just for everyone's understanding, the New York City Civil Court Act, Section 102A3, a vacancy occurring otherwise than by the expiration of the term in the office of judge of the Civil Court of the City of New York shall be filled by the mayor of the City of New York by an appointment which shall continue until and including the last day of December next, after the election at which the vacancy shall be filled. Shall be filled by the mayor. What in that language do you think allows the mayor to exercise the discretion to not fill a vacancy because there will not be an available other vacancy to a different position the following year?
You know, I read the Law Journal almost every day, and there was a wonderful decision within the last month that discussed the meaning of shall and whether it was absolutely mandatory or whether it provided authority. And the court in that case, and you know, I couldn't even find it if I had to, was it's not mandatory. It's saying that this is the authority to do it. You know, we can have a long legal discussion about mandatory and precatory and what the meaning of shall is and whatever, but I think what that means is that the mayor has the authority to do it and nobody else does.
Okay. Let me ask you about the mayor's executive order. It's executive order number 4. It's his executive order. Section 4, appointments by the mayor. B. Judicial vacancies shall be filled within 90 days unless a longer period is required in the public interest. Now, my reading of that, and I think a lot of people's reading of that, would be the mayor has to fill these vacancies within 90 days unless there's some issue in the vetting or the background process or the bar association, something out of the mayor's control or something out of the ordinary comes up. The mayor has to fill these within 90 days. Is it your position that this exception for a longer period required in the public interest covers the broader policy decision that we're not going to appoint someone because there's not a family court or a criminal court judgeship available in the next year?
Yes.
I have to say, that is an extraordinarily broad definition of the public interest. And I think that, you know, we talked about what makes someone a lawyer earlier, and you had opined about people turning in their license. You seem to be stretching the plain language of both the state statute and the mayor's own executive order to encompass this new broad policy determination. And this is the mayor's executive order. I think we've talked about the foundation of democracy and all these highfalutin things, and you are a man with impeccable good government credentials. I think if this is going to be the mayor's policy, he should make that clear in his executive order so that the public can really see what are the factors that the mayor is using to determine who should be elected, who should be appointed to this interim civil court position. The policy that you are adopting or bringing into this strikes me as almost obliterating the concept of an interim civil court judge. And if that's what you're going to do, if that's going to be a factor, and if there are going to be circumstances where someone is not going to be appointed an interim civil court judge because there's not a different position on the horizon, and that seat is not going to get filled, and that's going to be one less judge sitting in one of the criminal courts in New York City, which are so terribly backlogged,
I think there should be more clarity on that.
I guess we're going to disagree on that. We certainly believe that independence of the judiciary is a factor that is in the interest of the people, and as expressed there, we're going to continue to seek out and appoint the most highly qualified people we can, and we will continue to do it on an ongoing basis, filling vacancies as they occur as quickly as possible when it's appropriate to do so.
Let me ask you this before I let you go. If this is going to be part of your consideration, and I don't necessarily think that it's appropriate that it should be, and it certainly shouldn't be a bar, regardless, have you contemplated doing special, particular outreach to categories of lawyers who might be more than willing to give up a year of their professional life to go be a judge assigned in criminal court via being appointed interim civil court judge, and then at the end of that year, go back to their life, folks from the big firm world or attorneys in the judiciary who are other than judges, court attorneys, referees, et cetera, or government employees in the law department or in the city council, people who don't have this private practice that they would have to disconnect from for a year and whose employers might be willing to say, go be a judge for a year. It's an important public service. It seems to me that if this is going to be part of your consideration, that And then it's difficult to find people who can fill those positions for just a one-year gig. There needs to be some kind of special, particular strategy to find people who can fill that one-year gig.
We don't think that's a workable model. Mm-hmm. We disagree. Mm-hmm. This year was a bit of an unusual year with 13 interim civil court vacancies. On an ongoing basis, that's just not.
So probably the last question then. What is your strategy for finding people who are qualified, highly qualified, to fill these vacancies with the knowledge and expectation that this is a one-year assignment and on December 31st, your time as a judge in service to the people of the city of New York has come to an end?
Our strategy is to find the most highly qualified candidates we can appoint to the judge to serve long, full and complete and long terms, and that the interim civil court seat is an interim seat. We're not just filling interim seats. We're appointing judges who we expect to serve for the long term, and we will continue to.
Well, again, that position leads us where it seems that you have a fundamental disbelief in the role of an interim civil court judge, but that is a responsibility in law and the mayor to fill. And in the absence of a strategy for how you're going to fill those positions when you've decided that we don't want to roll people over or we're reluctant to roll people over, and that's why here we are April 19th and we still don't have judges who are sitting and hearing cases, I don't think it's acceptable that you can not adopt some kind of different recruiting strategy to meet this change in policy.
One, it's not a change in policy. Two, our record does not demonstrate a change in policy. Three, our record does not demonstrate that we leave seats empty when they should be filled. And four, we can certainly consider where we anticipate judges to be when we appoint them. And that means that we expect that when we appoint the judge to the bench, they're going to continue to serve the people of New York sitting on the bench on either the family or criminal court. And that's our goal and that's our obligation, and we continue to meet that obligation.
Well, respectfully, there is an obligation under the law to also fill the interim civil court positions. And the law does not qualify that by saying only if there's a 10-year appointment at the end of that year. And you are changing the fundamental approach and structure to how vacancies are filled. And you are doing so in a way where the results speak for themselves in this circumstance, where it is late April, and we have eight vacancies that have not been filled. they probably won't be filled at the earliest until May. And if you think that that doesn't have an impact on the lives of the people who are in our court system, then I think you're not being, then I think you're not really fulfilling your responsibility.
I couldn't disagree with you more. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The only other witness we have, we had a witness from the Bar Association, but he had to run. Correct or wrong?
Yeah,
okay. So he's had to run.
Yeah,
right? Is Judge Leibowitz. Judge Leibowitz, you've got to fill out a card. That's how we do it in the city council.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah.
How does it feel to be on the other side?
I've been there for a couple of years already.
I know. Come take a seat over there. You'll have them fill out afterwards. Is that okay?
Absolutely.
I have no. My name is Jeffrey Leibowitz.
Well, Judge.
Oh,
we
got to
do this.
Swear in.
Yeah.
How could a judge forget that? All right.
Yeah. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I certainly do.
Good. So why don't you tell us what brings you here today, and why don't you hit the clock for 5 minutes, and then we can, if you need more than that, we can do that.
Okay.
And start by introducing yourself, of course.
All right. My name is Jeffrey D. Leibowitz. I'm a retired justice of the state Supreme Court. I have always, during my 21 years as a judge, I was always part of the appointed process. First as an interim Supreme Court judge, where I hold a dubious record of serving 11 one-year terms.
Interim civil.
In civil, right. But I was appointed all that time to criminal court, as is normally the case, which started with the last year of Mayor Dinkins, the full administration of Mayor Giuliani, the first year of Mayor Bloomberg, who thereafter said he would never do a policy like that, and appointed me to the criminal court. Thereafter, I was appointed to the Court of Claims by Governor Patterson, and remained there as an acting Supreme Court judge, which I had been actually while I was an interim civil court judge, the only person who's ever done that, until I retired from the bench in 2014, returned to private practice, where I'm now with the law firm of Jaspin Schlesinger out in Garden City, New York.
And so how many times have you rolled over, so to speak?
I lost count, but I believe the record was 8 till I broke it, and I believe it was 10 or 11.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And you've heard some of the testimony here today. I know you weren't here for all of it. But the issue of your independence while you were an interim civil court judge being rolled over, and then in your other experiences, can you just talk to your experience with that?
Sure. I think that's a logical conclusion to make, that people certainly have certain concerns if they have a 1 or 2 year term versus a 10 year term, and I'm sure that from what I heard, the mayor is also committed to not keeping people in an interim status for too long. Mayor Bloomberg told me that by the end of the second year, we either knew we wanted to keep you or we didn't, meaning in general, so I think that's, but I will tell you that during that time, I tried to put that aside, and in fact, during 3 of those years, I presided over the first domestic violence part, as well as a combined youth part, and if people understand, that can be a very, very combustible situation, orders of protection, so on and so forth, and it would not be the part, perhaps, that someone with a year-to-year term would want to volunteer, but I did. And in fact, I had the unfortunate consequence of one of those people who received an order of protection actually being killed at the hands of her ex-husband. So somehow, you know, we learned from that and what we did perhaps long. Back then, it was much more of a collaborative effort between the DA's office and legal aid and the court system. But I feel that I added a lot during those years, and I feel that I did my best to keep my judicial independence intact, notwithstanding I knew that sometime in December of every year I would come before the mayor's committee again and the city association. Don't forget that the mayor won't appoint anybody that's not approved by the city association. So it's not just the mayor's committee. It is also the city association, which can be a grueling task because there's anywhere from 25 to 30 people that interview you at one given time.
So you were interim civil for X number of years, then went to?
I became a criminal court judge, didn't really change anything that I was doing. By that time, I was already an acting Supreme Court judge doing criminal work, and then I got a criminal court spot, but then eventually, because of my desire, I moved to do the civil term, where I remained for the last 10 years of my career, including 4 years in 6 years in the matrimonial part. And in 2009, towards the end of my time in the matrimonial department, I was appointed by Governor Patterson to a nine-year term at the Court of Claims, which I didn't fill out because I decided to retire and return to private practice.
So you had a number of appointments over the course of your career.
You could say that, yes.
And at any time, did you feel that your independence was compromised or undermined to the point where you couldn't perform the functions of a judge through these various different appointing mechanisms?
No, in fact, just to share with the committee and the people here, there were times when I sat in arraignment, and arraignment can be a tough place. You can, you're making very quick decisions, and you try to do the best you can. And sometimes I would think, am I making a decision that's in any way colored by this one-year term? And I tried to put that out of my mind, but people are human beings, and I don't care if you have a one-year term, a five-year term, an eight-year term. You know, those are issues. Nobody wants to see themselves in the front page of the Post. But I did the best I could to continue to be judicially independent. I will say, to the credit to Mayor Bloomberg and to Mayor de Blasio, they have not created that same environment that existed earlier on, where judges' decisions, even if they turned out to be wrong, were second-guessed. I think there's a lot less of that. But obviously, you raise an issue that was in my mind, and I tried to do the best I could not to be affected by it, and I don't think I was.
And when you say earlier on, that's a reference to the Giuliani years when he had gotten rid of the executive order and the committee and all that, as I recall.
Well, I'll just say this. Even though I never got a full term from Mayor Giuliani, he always reappointed me. But it was a different period of time in terms of judges, and judges were concerned. I think judges, regardless of their term, as I said, always have that in the back of their mind. It requires a certain amount of tenacity on your part and strength of character to not be affected by it. And I can say that, having sat 3 years doing domestic violence while I was on a year-to-year term, that I think I discharged my functions without reference to the fact that I was subject to a one-year reappointment at the end of the year.
So my last leading question for this hearing.
No, there's nobody to reject, so there's all right.
It's good to be the councilman.
Yeah.
Is judges across the spectrum, unless you're a federal judge with life tenure, although I've heard of district court judges who aspire to be in the Court of Appeals, and Court of Appeals judges who aspire to be in the Supreme Court, and everyone's watching their P's and Q's, and maybe they're judges of the Supreme Court of the United States who'd like to be the chief one day. But judges across the spectrum in New York, whether elected or appointed, face some challenges to their independence. But if you elect or appoint people of integrity, and the appointing authority, whether it's the mayor or the governor, has integrity and has a professional process in place, we should be okay.
Yeah, I think it has to do more with the individual than the term, and that you can get people who are concerned. But let's face it, a lot of times the mayor will only have a three-year term to fill out, not because he wants to give them less than that, but that's the term they're filling out, and that person
meaning
has to
the
work.
Last 3 years
right,
and
so
a 10-year term? Is that what
right,
you mean?
Right, that you can end up picking up the term of someone who retires. Like these judges were turning 70. They're probably in the Supreme Court already because of how much experience they have, but the thing is, they may retire and have only 2 years left, or a year left, or 5 years left. So they can just as easily be affected by it. So I think that at the end of the day, it has to do with the character of the particular person and less to do with the term, though there obviously is some facile logic in the fact that if you have to come up every year, that's got to affect you at some point.
Emphasis facile.
Huh?
Emphasis facile.
Yes, that's exactly.
Thank you all very much. That concludes our hearing.